And I saw records made, music literally written in wax. The first step, I learned, is to pour a thin layer of molten wax onto a hot plate, the beginning of the master record. A hot flame melts all bubbles and flaws out of the wax, which is of the purest possible grade. This is done in a sealed, dust-proof and air-conditioned room where the temperature is thermostatically controlled. A second going over with the flame and the wax is ready for slow and careful cooling, almost ready for the recording of the music. Meticulous examination ensures smooth perfection before the wax is passed through a special slot to the recording room. The perfect wax is put on the turntable, a cutting point called a stylus is adjusted, and everything is ready to record again the most popular selection ever caught on wax, the beautiful Blue Danube Waltz of Johann Strauss. The sound engineer is ready. The musicians are set. And I see a record made. The engineer mixes the sound to achieve the best musical balance in the record. Vibrations of sound brought from the microphones pass through this cutting head to the stylus. The stylus, in turn, cuts the vibrations in the soft wax, records the poetic tones forever. Recording is finished, the soft disc is washed with nitrogen and put into a chamber with a block of pure gold. A 2500 volt electrical current, I was amazed to learn, bombards atoms of gold onto the wax, coating it completely. The gold covered disc is put into a solution of copper sulfate through which a powerful electrical current runs, transferring molecules of copper from the solution to the record. As a result of this process, called electrolysis, the disc comes out plated with copper, immortal music written in metal. In a second bath, the copper coating is further built up. In these baths, electricity flows through the solution between two poles, one a block of copper and the other the disc itself. When the current passes from the copper into the solution, it carries with it charged molecules of metal called ions, which are drawn to the disc and penetrate its tiniest recesses, taking the exact shape of the grooves made by the original sound vibrations, ensuring perfect fidelity of tone in the final record. From this furiously bubbling cauldron comes the master record. After the copper has taken the impression, the wax may be stripped away. This master matrix now could be used to press the final records, I was told, but it would not last long enough to turn out the millions of discs music lovers demand. Hence another disc, called a mother matrix, must be made first, and from that, stampers will be made to press the final records. When the master is finally stripped, the last traces of wax are washed away. The master matrix is carefully rinsed and scrubbed. Then it's given another electrolytic bath, this time of nickel, which I learned gives it a still harder outer coating. After this bath, the master is washed and dipped into a special solution that coats it with a fine film. Now into another copper bath, and this time the mother matrix starts to build up on the face of the master, taking the shape of the same grooves, capturing again the sweet tones of the flowing music. The double disc is now separated into mother and master, and the master matrix goes down to the treasure house of music to be preserved for all time, to take its place beside the works of the world's greatest artists. The mother matrix is thoroughly washed and cleaned and goes into a nickel bath to give it a more durable surface. After another washing and film coating, it goes into another copper bath where the stamping matrix starts to build up. The double disc bubbles in its bath until the tiny electrified particles of copper grow into a hard, strong coating and the plating is finished. Now the mother matrix and stamper, locked face to face, are separated. From the mother, additional stampers will be made so that many finished records may be pressed at one time. Before the stamper is ready to use, it receives a nickel plating and then another coat, this time of hard gleaming chromium to give it resistance enough to last through many pressings. The matrix is washed once more. And now with other stampers, it will soon be ready to press the finished records. For still greater strength, the completed matrix is soldered to a rigid backing. For perfect contact with the hot backing, the stamper is heated with flame, protected with a chemically neutral blanket, and pressed evenly into the hot solder. When the gleaming disc is removed from the press, it is ready for the next operation, the centering of the hole around which the finished record will revolve. This delicate mechanism centers the hole with meticulous precision and is checked by magnification. Looking through the magnifier, I saw the rotating grooves of the music itself caught on the record. Carefully, the technician centers the disc, and with the lens, he checks again. With the position of the hole accurately determined, he drills it with infinite accuracy on dead center. Now the stamper is given a last washing so no speck of dust can make even the tiniest mark that would create the smallest false sound. On this revolving cleaning machine, I saw the disc receive its final polishing. But before going to the actual pressing of records, I was shown the mixing of the materials that go into the disc you hear at home, ingredients gathered from the farthest corners of the earth. The materials are processed in one of the largest and most intricate machines I have ever seen, the Banbury Mixer. One ingredient is the finest shellac obtainable, which is brought from India. Another resin ingredient is from the East Indies and, like the shellac, is ground into fine powder before mixing. Eighteen other ingredients gathered from distant places are carefully and accurately weighed in to ensure the most exact proportions to make a correct final mixture. All ingredients are finely ground and put into the mixer to be carefully combined under heat with the powdered shellac, which is sucked into the machine through a vacuum pipe. Now all is ready, and the Banbury mixer rolls. Inside this huge machine, three stories tall, the mixture is heated to the melting point, whipped and stirred and beaten until it is thoroughly mixed to a dough-like consistency. The hot mixture falls out on great rollers where it is kneaded and rolled into a long, flat sheet. As it comes out of the machine, circular knives cut it into pieces called biscuits, each the right size to make one record. The biscuits, cooled for easy handling, come off the belt in neat little piles, but before they are used for actual pressing, they must be heated again on steam tables. Then I saw a record pressed. First, steam is shot through the machine, then cold water runs through to cool the record. Two different stampers are used in the machine at the same time to press the two sides of the record simultaneously. The labels are put in before the biscuit, I learned, and actually pressed into the record, not just pasted on. Many presses working at the same time turn out many records together to satisfy the music-hungry thousands. The edge of the record is carefully polished. After this is finished, comes a listening test, when the record is actually played for expert ears. now examined and found flawless, the records are polished and slipped into envelopes ready for packing and shipment. They are counted, boxed, and carried by conveyor belt to the shipping room. From this room, the records go out to all parts of the world to bring joy and pleasure to millions of music lovers, to give them permanently the music they want when they want it. Now the genius of artist and engineer, the work of many hands, have brought the record to its destination. From its tiny grooves, the recorded vibrations of sound will be picked up by the jewel point, amplified electrically, and the beautiful Blue Danube fulfills its mission in an ideal combination for the home. No matter what it is you want to hear at your command performance, it is recorded for you by the world's greatest artists.
To begin with, a new orthophonic high-fidelity recording is not just the mechanical reproduction of a concert performance. It's the art of creating the effect of a concert performance. There are many stops and starts, many takes and retakes. That's because the end object is a planned illusion. The illusion, as you ultimately hear the music played back through your phonograph, that you have the best seat in the concert hall. How do they do it? Well, the recording music director, or any one of the sound engineers, could easily explain it all in 10 weeks. But let's just take a look at three of the fundamental requirements of high-fidelity recording. The first is full dynamic range. That's the spread between the softest and loudest passages in the music. In a concert performance, the range is as wide as the conductor feels the score indicates. These meters on the recording console indicate the volume of sound coming from the orchestra onto the magnetic tape. In the old days, home phonographs could not reproduce either full loud passages or very soft passages. So they were literally kept off the record right here by sound monitoring. But it wasn't a faithful reproduction of the actual performance, such as you get with today's high fidelity recording techniques. Today, as it should be, the conductor and his musicians control all of the dynamics, including all of the natural shadings, just as they do in a concert. And after the recording begins, the engineer never touches the controls. The full dynamic power of the orchestra is faithfully transferred to the recording tape. The second requirement is somewhat similar, achieving natural balance between all instruments and sections of the orchestra. This can only be achieved by precise microphone placement. And this varies amazingly with the music, the particular artists, the hall itself, even climatic conditions. It is never the same from one recording session to another. Again, an easy solution might be found here by the arbitrary placement and control of many microphones. But again, it wouldn't be natural or faithful reproduction. Today, the engineers record the orchestra as a complete unit. third important requirement in a high-fidelity recording is frequency range, capturing high notes as well as low. This is actually accomplished before the session begins. All it takes is recording equipment of enormous cost and capacity, such as this recording console. It faithfully handles all sounds audible to the human ear. The entire frequency spectrum from 20 to 20,000 cycles per second. And with less than 0.2% distortion, it transfers them to the swiftly spinning magnetic tape. A new challenge here is stereophonic recording. This requires dual mics, dual track tape machines, and a stereophonic mixer. But for those who have the equipment, it also permits two-system or stereophonic playback in the home. There are other high-fidelity requirements, such as presence, definition, clarity. But with time and patience, and enough retakes, they get on the record too. Eventually, there is a playback that everyone recognizes as the image they were seeking, both artistically and acoustically. They have a truly faithful recording of Romeo and Juliet. And we are one step closer to having it in our homes. Next stop, New York City, and the precise engineering business of transferring the recorded sound from tape to a disc called the Lacquer Master. This disc is the grandfather of the records to come later. Let's look at the steps in the cutting of our Lacquer Master. Most of the sound factors are already known. The speed of the tape in recording, its playing time, and the sound level required. These factors must be considered for both 45 RPM and long play Lacquer Masters. A special Lacquer Master disc is closely inspected. For the 12-inch long play record, the master is 16 inches in diameter. For 45 extended play records, the master is 12 inches in diameter. In both cases, the extra width allows plenty of working room in cutting. Besides a spindle for centering, the turntable has a number of holes. Through these holes, air suction holds the lacquer disc down tightly, so it is perfectly flat on the turntable. The playing time of the music determines the number of grooves per inch that will be cut into the record. The sound dynamics of the music determine how far apart the grooves must be. Loud passages need more space between grooves. Soft passages need less. The cutting machine automatically spaces the music grooves according to the sound signal it's receiving. Now, a test cut to determine the groove width. The groove width must be exact, so exact that it is carefully checked through a microscope. Everything's set, and a coarse pitch lead-in groove is cut to the music area. The tape machine is started, and exactly 1.5 turns before the music begins, the cutting head automatically changes from the lead-in groove to fine pitch music grooves. The cutting stylus is a minute piece of sapphire, perfectly ground and electrically heated, so there is virtually no resistance as it cuts into the smooth lacquer. During the cutting operation, a constant watch is kept on the groove width to make sure it never varies from the prescribed setting. It all sounds so simple when you're just skimming the surface. Actually, of course, it's a painstaking and delicate operation. But in time, you have a perfect lacquer master. The original tape goes to the vault for safekeeping, to take its place forever alongside many other priceless performances by the world's greatest artists. All the artistry of the Romeo and Juliet performance is being carefully preserved. And we're another step closer to having that performance in our own living rooms. Next stop, Indianapolis, Indiana. One of three processing plants to which our lacquer master might go. We start in production control. Here, every lacquer master is assigned a shadow, a special business machine card. From now on, this card can lead you straight to our particular recording, no matter where it might be in processing. The processing is identical for long play and 45 RPM records. First, the grooves in the lacquer master are carefully rechecked through a microscope. They have to be perfect. Now we proceed to make metal copies from the lacquer master. The first step, silvering. This takes precisely 2 minutes and 40 seconds. And the lacquer master comes out with a new face. Now, by patient electroplating, we add a series of metallic deposits, one behind the other. First, a fine-grained deposit of nickel. This makes smooth-walled grooves and a quieter surface. Next, a thin deposit of copper over the nickel. A nice, smooth, salmon pink. Now, a whirling bath in another tank. A much heavier buildup of copper. We'll see why in a moment. We now have a master disc that is apparently all back and no front. But watch. Now we have two fronts and two masters. The original lacquer master is on the left. A new silver-faced master is on the right. But this is the point where most people long for a road map. Let's make one. We started with the lacquer master. To the face of it, we added first silver, then nickel, then copper, and finally, a lot more copper. Then we separate the lacquer from the metal. Now we have both our original lacquer master and a new silver-faced or metal master. The grooves in the lacquer master make it a positive. It can be played. The matching ridges on the metal master make it a negative. It cannot be played. We continue work with the metal master, repeating the gradual metal buildup to make another part. Then, another separation. The metal master is at the left, and the new part, called a mold, is at the right. We have progressed from the original positive to a negative to another positive. The metal master normally goes back immediately to build up another mold, but that depends on the next important step. The mold can be played, so it is promptly readied for a sound test. The mold is thoroughly cleaned to prevent damage in the test play. In any Name That Tune contest, put your money on a record tester. 8 hours a day, and all kinds of music. She loves it. More important, she is an expert at hearing the slightest imperfection on a record surface. And should she find any, a new lacquer master from the original tape is immediately ordered from New York. After audio testing, the mold goes back to the plating tanks. It produces the most important new metal part, the stamper. This completes the cycle. Lacquer to master, master to mold, mold to stamper. The metal buildup to the stamper is exactly the same, except for one thing. The stamper is nearly all pure hard nickel. Its ridges press the playing grooves into the finished record. Now it's prepared for stamping. Ground perfectly smooth on the back. Optically center punched for the record press. Trimmed to exact diameter. And coined. given a formed edge to grasp the stamping die securely. The record press is a complicated piece of equipment weighing 2 tons. It molds records by compression. Our stamper is mounted on the top die. Below it, another stamper simultaneously presses the other side of the record. The record compound, the finest pure vinyl obtainable, is fed into the press in granular form. It is forced by hydraulic pressure into a soft plastic, in just the right amount for one record. The labels are pressed right into the record. Now we're ready to roll. It has taken many steps and many man hours to get here. But a new record is stamped every few seconds. The record press automatically heats the vinyl plastic for stamping, then automatically cools it, so the record can be played immediately. And here's the first long play copy of Romeo and Juliet. A collector's item? No. The first pressing is always carefully inspected for everything from the correct serial number to perfect centering. Then, still another playback test. And finally, the pressing of the Romeo and Juliet gets going in earnest. And for those who prefer the 45 extended play version, and for the millions of teenagers anxiously awaiting the latest pop hit, an ingenious machine turns them out automatically. It places its own labels, feeds itself the vinyl compound, removes its own records, and stacks them already trimmed. And for the fast-growing legions of tape enthusiasts, equally ingenious machines turn out duplicate copies at 4 times the playback speed to save time, and backwards to save rewinding. And no matter what your taste or preference in music, in the packaging area you discover unlimited variety, the finest in sound and performance. Children's albums, the unusual, show tunes, or country music, pop hits and jazz classics. And party music? Mood music? Grand opera? Instrumental solos, symphonic, or other classical masterpieces. The world's greatest artists are at your service. It's a big operation. But no matter what type of music you prefer, or whether you want it on 45 extended play, or 33 and a third long play, every record is made with the same care and to the same high fidelity standards. And the Romeo and Juliet, getting closer to home all the time. A final inspection. Every record is carefully checked by experienced packers who know almost at a glance if the record is up to standard. In its own distinctive sleeve, another new orthophonic high-fidelity recording, finally ready for shipment. A new mechanical shipping technique helps to speed it on its way. Here, in the shipping control room, special machines keep track of the 250,000 new records made here every day. Which records go where? When? In what quantities? The cards tell you. The Romeo and Juliet recording goes out in both 45 extended play and long play versions. The sorting machine divides the Romeo and Juliet shipping instructions into these two categories. Now the shippers take over. Both versions are shipped in the same way, in cartons of 25 records. But let's follow the cartons of 45 extended play albums. As they're picked from the storage bins, the cartons are placed on a unique distribution rack invented here. From now on, one girl keeps everything running smoothly. As each order is filled according to the punch card instructions, she changes the setting on an automatic addressing machine. And the equipment does the rest. The code number and address of the record distributor for this order is automatically stamped on each carton. Then the cartons pass through another machine, where they are bundled together in groups of four. And away they go to the accumulation area down below on another floor. Here, the cartons are accumulated for shipment to distributors and record dealers in all parts of the country. These long play albums have been through the same shipping process as the 45s. And now both versions are on the home stretch. Hundreds of identical and faithful copies of one high-fidelity recording. Tchaikovsky's Romeo and Juliet. Tchaikovsky's Romeo and Juliet. It's traveled a long way for an illusion. The last stop, home, and the best seat in the concert hall.